Dishes off, Doughty one-timer, stop, Hunter scores on the rebound. They're 3-for-3, and the Kings lead 3-1.
This is going to go down as the worst penalty killing in Canucks history. Can anybody kill off a penalty, a power play, for crying out loud? This is unbelievable. It's like men against boys when the Kings are on the power play.
Welcome back to Rogers Arena. Kings and the Canucks will do it again, just like they did it back in the playoffs. Blake Price here with you. You're listening to the Sussex Insurance pregame show brought to you by Rogers Wireless. Lost, stolen, or broken, you're covered with a Rogers handset protection guarantee. For full details, visit the Rogers dealer near you. Yes, the one and only Tom Larscheid. Certainly had a knack for calling it like it is. That was just a few months ago.
You guys are killing me.
You ready for this?
No wonder they gave me the boot. even I didn't know I was that blunt.
It was six in a row.
Well, you know what? Enough's enough, eh, Shorty? I mean, I couldn't take it any longer.
That was unbelievable. That really was unbelievable. Needless to say, Tom Larscheid and John Shorthouse join us here on the Sussex Insurance pregame show. We're going to deal with the game coming up later on in the hour, guys, and there's lots to talk about from a hockey scenario here, but it's going to be a lot of fun, I'm sure, for you guys to have one last run through 60 minutes of hockey.
Well, Blake, it really is. I feel terrific right now. That was a terrific opening.
I was just killing myself laughing. I think you guys were too. It's
been a fun ride. I can't thank all of you enough. What pros I've worked with all these years. And I'm going out with just nothing but the best of memories. It's going to be fun tonight, Shorty. Blake, let's go for it, and we'll talk about anything you want to talk about.
We talked in late July when this all started to come down, and that was going to be it. And you know, Tommy, I was in Victoria. I was on a ferry when I got the word, called Tommy from Victoria, and hadn't really thought it through. And Tom said, well, they've asked me to do one last game, and they'd like me to do the season opener. I thought, you know, wouldn't that be great? How many times in this industry, really, do you get the opportunity to have that farewell and to do that last thing and to feel, you know, great about it? And so, I, you know, thank you for doing this, first of all, and we're going to have a lot of fun tonight.
Well, Shorty, you know, I thank Team 1040, the management, and I also thank the Vancouver Canucks for giving me this opportunity to do it one more time and be able to thank everybody that has been so instrumental and so supportive of my career all these years. This is going to be a lot of fun. It's the 40th anniversary of the hockey club. A big night, a real big night, and it's going to be a fun year for all you guys. I'm happy I'm here to be able to kick it off with you.
You know, I was thinking about it yesterday, and I listened, Tom, you were great with Pratt and Taylor yesterday afternoon. Boy, that was a fun hour.
It was.
And, you know, I was listening, and people were talking about the evolution of Tom Larscheid. Mm-hmm. And you talked a lot about what your philosophy was in coming into the booth and how Ted Smith, when he first hired you, who was taking a chance, but he, you know, told you clear off the top or early on when he didn't really like the way you were going about it, that he wanted the entertainment and he wanted the extension of the fan. And he wanted, you know, a guy who lived and died and reacted to what was happening on the ice the way the fan does in the stands or at home, in the car. And I was thinking about it because, you know, people have said, well, you know, Tom has really, through the years, become tougher on the team. And I was thinking about, you know what that is, really? It's a compliment to the team because for a lot of years there, up until the early 90s, really, 82 was a fluke, let's be honest, okay? That team came out of nowhere and found its way in the Stanley Cup Final. And God bless those guys. You know, I love them all. But that was lightning in a bottle, if there ever was, with Richard Bruder leading the way. So really, up until the early 90s, this was a very sad franchise, you know. But when the standards got raised, to me, to have a higher bar and to have higher expectations and to therefore be a little more blunt in your commentary.
Well, the fans are harder on the team now.
It is a compliment to the fact that this has become a premier franchise in the National Hockey League. And I really, truly believe that. And it hadn't really dawned on me until I really started thinking about it when I was listening to you yesterday on the radio.
Well, you know, Shorty, I've had a lot of time now to think about all these years and what made me tick. And I have to tell everybody, and I think you guys know it because you watched me experience it, but every time for all these years that I've come into the broadcast booth, I get a rush. And when that red light goes on, I'm really ready to go. And it's been like that every game I've ever done. And if there's one thing that I think people should know about me is the fact that I cared too much. I cared too much about our team. But you know what? I'm happy that I have cared, because otherwise I'd never be able to show the passion I have for this great sport and the passion for our team and our city and what it means to our city. And so I just wanted people to feel what I felt in the booth as I was doing a game with Robson and Houston and Shorty and Ball and J. Paul McConnell and Dan Russell, whoever it was that we worked with as a play-by-play guy. And I'll talk a lot about you guys tonight. But, you know, it was just, I really have always felt I was an extension of the fan. I like to think that I asked the questions when I did interviews that the fan wanted me to ask. Some of them were really tough, and sometimes the guy that I was asking didn't like it, but I asked it. And the other thing, too, is if for one, when I talked about this yesterday, if for 1 minute that the players and the coaches and management don't think that the sellout crowd isn't thinking the same thing that I'm talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
They
yeah,
are.
Yeah.
And that's where I felt so good about fans who have come up and shook my hand and say that, boy, your passion, your enthusiasm, it's inspired me. It's made me a Canuck hockey fan. Boy, that makes me feel good. Because you know what? They're yelling at their TV set or at the radio just the way I'm yelling up here at the broadcast booth. Or they're going over the moon when Henrik and Daniel have put together those beautiful passes and tic-tac-toe and it's in the net and we're all coming out of our seat. Just like the Russian Rocket used to do at Pavel Bure and Bertuzzi and Naslin and Morrison and Stan Smeal and Fraser and Gradin. You know, I talked about them all. I loved it. I still do. And I have the utmost respect for every player that ever wore the Vancouver Canucks jersey. They're the best of the best. And I know how tough it is to play at the top level, and I've respected every one of these guys who have ever played, and I think they all knew it, too.
Well, absolutely, and that's why I said when Shorty was talking to you about how you've evolved as a broadcaster, the fans have evolved. 40 years, we're marking 40 years of this franchise. There's no Stanley Cup banner in there.
No.
So as a result, fans have become more discerning about the team that they see on the ice, and you reflected that over the years. So
yeah,
it's been,
well, thanks, Blake. It's been a fun ride. It really has, and I'm so tickled and pink to be able to do one more with you guys. I really am. And I hope I keep it together.
You will.
I hope so.
Yeah. We didn't always keep it together. Which brings me, you know, and you know, Ian McIntyre wrote a lovely column the other day, and Tony Gallagher in The Province. And Tony made the point in his, you know, that there were times where he actually feared for his safety and his life because of the size of the gut-busting laughs that were emanating from his body through experiences with you. And I've had the same experiences through the last dozen years. I can't believe it's been 12 years.
I know.
It just flew by. Anyway, with that in mind, and we're going to have lots of tributes tonight, and you're going to have fun with it, I hope, Tom. But our producer here, Mike Whittingham, has put together some of the lighter moments of the last dozen years, and certainly the last few years in particular. So courtesy the senior executive producer of Canucks Hockey and the Team 1040 and the Canucks Radio Network.
He better turn my mic off, though. I'll be laughing too hard.
Here's some of the fun times the last few years.
My arm?
There we go.
You're on, buddy.
Did you put the mic in front of your mouth? Is that how it works?
Hey, we're in radio.
There you go. Canucks won, the Hawks nothing as we go to the second period.
Hey, let me ask
here.
You something. When you're doing television, do they put the headset on
you? Yeah, exactly. You've got a dresser.
I mean, they wipe the back of your
exactly.
So, my goodness.
Anyway, it's 1-0 Canucks as we go to the second period here in Vancouver's on the power play.
It's Joe the Plumber in here.
You know, this is the club's position that they just kind of hit the wall there in January. That and boy, did they ever. But now, I mean...
How about you? Did you hit the wall last night?
I hit the wall today. Yeah. I hit four walls when I got home. There was a staff party last night.
You did a great
show. Shorty put on a little show.
Oh, they played all his records.
Just a second. I want to hear about the Purina Challenge. Come on, you guys. Give me the Purina Challenge here. My dog would eat the Purina. And I got two dogs, you know. I got two dogs. And Christ, can these guys eat? I'm out of here. I'll see you guys tomorrow. Who has more fun than the Tommy gun, right?
Oh, yeah. Johnny Ferreira playing the sax here. Those boots were made for walking. Hey, Johnny. There you go. Take it on home.
And the opening faceoff is brought to you by Wolf Langley Mazda and Wolf Chilliwack Mazda, Fraser Valley's number one Mazda stores.
Somebody turn on the fan in here. My goodness, it's hot.
The Canuck captain carries all the way back to the blue line. Nazem cuts to the right point. Now skates quickly down the right wing. Nazem round behind the net. He's doing laps in the Minnesota zone.
Do another one.
Now back to Brian Allen. He'll send the puck in deep for Brendan Morrison. They're playing keep away.
What, are you some kind of a goof?
How do you like that little bit they do now after John Ashbridge announces the goal? Woo!
Woo! He had a Jay McClellan on before.
Oh, is this Lee?
Yeah, no.
Oh, okay. We had Jay McClellan on. Lee Stempniak joins us now. Lee, tell us then, we'll change the question.
You guys are playing games with us down there.
He just continues to do it, doesn't he? Boy, the popcorn's good here.
I would swear you're pregnant.
The way I'm eating?
Well, no, you're going, not only eating, but you're going between the ice cream and the popcorn and back to the ice cream and back to the popcorn. 20 grand. Yes? 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 Yes! We got it, I think, Tom.
Oh, no.
We got it. We got it. We got it.
Where?
We got it.
3-1-6.
We got it.
We do!
We got it!
He's vicious that way, and Pronger's been getting away with murder for years. It's about time the league cracked down on guys like this.
To the strains of La Cucaracha, the Canucks in a 5-2 lead over Nashville. Thank you, Mike.
That's that little spark to the building, hasn't it? La cucaracha, me he wanna que fumar. Porque tiene, porque le falta, me he wanna que fumar. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
That is why you're the best in the business. Yeah.
Indeed, the best in the business.
Oh, my goodness, you guys. I don't know if I can work tonight. I don't remember half that stuff. I really don't, but it is funny.
You do remember because two words into each sentence, you knew it was coming and you were getting ready for it.
I know. Oh, I hope they have enjoyed it listening to as we have here in the booth
hey,
tonight.
It made sense to us.
Oh, I know. Oh, this is terrific. I'm just having a ball.
Well, we've got one more night to put a few more additions, maybe some last-minute additions on this whole thing. And I'm sure, honestly, the chemistry between you guys, when you first stepped into the booth, both of you, I mean, when did you know that it was just going to work?
Well, I'm the one that really knew. I think the first time I had him in, everybody knows the story now. Shorty's told it, I've told it, that I introduced this young up-and-coming broadcaster. Remember the name. John Stackhouse. It was so funny. And I'll tell you, and then next year, lo and behold, he gets the job and he comes in and he sits next to me. And I told Shorty this. I liked him from the day I watched him on Sports Page on television. And when he came in the booth, I had no preconceived opinions or notions about this guy. I liked him. And the minute we got together, it was instant chemistry. I've told people all about this. And that just doesn't happen in business, in our profession.
Yeah.
It takes a while to get to know each other and to be able to bounce off each other, support each other, enhance our work together. And you know what? The listeners know when there's chemistry in the booth.
And everybody has said to me, nobody's had the chemistry like you and Shorty. And they're right.
Great magic.
And they're right.
Great magic. Guys, more from you in 15 minutes' time. You're listening to King of Floors Hockey, the Team 1040, and the Canucks Radio Network. Team in the broadcast booth that should qualify, because you guys, I could see you guys playing like a two-man scramble or something like that on the golf course sometime.
No, Murph's my guy now.
I know you. 19 under, did I hear?
Yeah.
I heard he carried you, though.
He shot 68 on his own ball.
Enough with guys who shoot 85 or 84 on a good day. He's a front runner.
I know. Fair weather guy, honestly. Yeah.
Well, we've been on once already, half an hour ago, Tom, and I guess we should talk about the hockey game.
There is a hockey game.
It's a big night. I mean, it's a 40th anniversary. It's a season opener. It's 40 years to the day that these teams hooked up at Pacific Coliseum. Tonight they do it at Rogers Arena. But let's I'm interested in your overall feeling about this Canucks hockey team. There's a lot of hype. There's a lot of expectation. There are people with pretty good hockey pedigrees, if you will, picking this team to go all the way this year. So what do you think? Is it all deserved?
Oh, absolutely, it's deserved. You have to have a lot of things break your way, I think, to make it all the way to the Stanley Cup and win it. You have to be healthy for starters. Mike Gillis has done a superb job of beefing up the Canuck defense. He's added a lot of skill, too, and you guys will be talking about it all year, and the likes of Keith Ballard, Dan Hamhuis. I really love those additions. They've got some size. They need a little more sandpaper in the third and fourth lines. That's what Elaine Vigneault, that's the kind of team he likes. They've got a couple of lines that are capable of scoring every night. We'll talk about the Raymonds and the Kesslers, Torreys, and, of course, when Burroughs gets back coming off a 35-goal season. And what can you say about the Twins?
Yeah.
Two of the greatest players in franchise history. Each year they pride themselves on being better. How can you be better than 112 points, win the Art Ross Trophy, and also the Hart Trophy as the most valuable player in the National Hockey League? Henrik did that. These are two great, great players. Samuelson with 30 goals last year. He'll start the year now with the Twins. So there's a lot of firepower in this team. Roberto Luongo doesn't have the pressures now of facing the media and all the things that go with being a team captain. He can concentrate on stopping the puck. He's a world-class goaltender. We all know that. I think he's due for a bounce back here to be really the premier goaltender in the National Hockey League.
I can be interested right off the hop because Luongo's October, I don't know if struggles is the right word, but I guess it is. You know, I've been well chronicled with the Canucks in October. He's gone 23-20-1, three games above 500. Then you look at the other months, 132 wins, 67 losses, and 24 in the third column. And as a team under Alain Vigneault, the Canucks have yet to really have a strong October. I think with this eight games between the preseason and the regular season, I think that's really what they're focusing on for the first time under Vigneault, to have a strong start and not have to play any kind of catch-up, which they've done well, winning three division titles in 4 years.
Yeah, they really have. I think it's important to get a good start to the season. You know, everybody talks about the 94 team that went all the way to the Stanley Cup final against the Rangers. If you take a look at that team, they all said, well, you know, they tailed off. They weren't the 100-point team. They were just a little bit above 500. But guess what? Take a look at what they did to start the season. I think they won 9 of their first 10 games.
Yeah.
So they really got out of the gate. That was a very talented hockey team. I think this will help this team, too, if they get out of the gate, because these points in October are just as important as the points you pick up in March and April.
Well, and it's not going to be easy. I can't remember. It's off the top of my head, but I think they play 11 of their first 18 on the road, and they play 11 of their last 17 on the road. So, you know, the time to make hay, you would think, would be in that middle portion where it's going to be home heavy. But they can't worry about that. They have to win if they're going to get off to a good start wherever the games are played. And thankfully, it starts for them here tonight at Rogers Arena against the LA Kings. You talked about the Twins a moment ago. We're going to find out officially the naming of the captain of the Canucks in the next 20 minutes, half an hour. Can it be anyone other than Henrik Sedin? Will you be shocked if it is?
I'd be a little shocked. If Ryan Kesler gets the C, I don't think I'd be shocked about that. I love what Ryan Kesler brings to this team. He's got bite in his play. He's a moody guy. He certainly can inspire, I think, his teammates. But Henrik Sedin, I think these two guys, Daniel or Henrik, but particularly Henrik, he's a quiet leader. And there's been some very successful hockey teams in the history of the NHL that have had soft-spoken captains.
Mm-hmm.
And they lead on the ice. And when they talk, the team listens. They might not do it all the time. I think Henrik's ready to lead this team. I think he'd be a great choice if he is the captain.
That little ovation you just heard down there, Christian Reed, just talked about you working the game tonight for the final time, and that was the ovation. That's nice. From the fans here at Rogers Arena. You know, you talk about Henrik and leading by example, and Ryan Kessler leads by example, too. There's no question about that. But you talk about an Art Ross and a Hart Trophy. I mean, there's a little weight behind that, too, and that just kind of adds to the resume and kind of the reverence, I would say, that the rest of the team would have towards him, don't you think?
Well, not only what his teammates have for him, how about around the league? I mean, his reputation is enhanced big time. Anytime you win a Hart Trophy, you know, MVP, and an Art Ross Trophy, I mean, you're up with the greats of the greats that ever played this game. The Rocket Richards, the Gordie Howes, the Bobby Orrs, you know, the Gretzky's, the Lemieux's. I mean, really, this is heavy-duty company. And boy, I'll tell you what, it looks good on him. Vancouver hockey fans have to just sit back and say, are we ever fortunate to have Henrik and Daniel Sedin as Vancouver Canucks? That's how good they are now.
It's interesting. You know, I don't know if he can duplicate 112 points. I mean, it was just such a magical year. But then if you think, okay, well, what, if Daniel plays the whole year, then why can't he? But to see the comments from Henrik, and I don't want this whole pregame to be about Henrik Sedin, but why not? He's such an important part of this hockey team. But to read his comments about how somebody like Steve Yzerman in Detroit transformed his game and went from being a prolific scorer to a champion. And there may be a difference, you know, and if that's an adjustment he has to make, he's willing to do it. And, you know, it's exciting to hear players talk like that when they're trying to develop championship mettle, which I think this entire group is trying to do, led by Henrik.
Yeah, and you know what? They have now, you know, scraped their knees and their elbows because they haven't been able to get over the hump. The window of opportunity to be a championship hockey team is only there so long. This is a great core group. Hopefully in the offseason, Mike Gillis and his staff and scouts and everybody else have done a good enough job, Shorty, to bring in the missing pieces of the puzzle, guys that have the character to reach down deep when you're really facing adversity and you're able to come up and play the best possible hockey that is required at that time to pull out victory. I hope that this is a collection of those kind of players.
All right. Tonight, one journey begins, and another comes to an end.
Oh, I love this. This is too much fun here tonight. This is the hockey game of the year. There's no question about it.
The end of an era and the start of a season. The Canucks and the LA Kings live from Rogers Arena. NHL hockey on the Team 1040 in the Canucks Radio Network.
Bonjour, Tom, and many congrats on your great career, where you not only brought the games to life for what has to be hundreds of thousands of hockey and football fans who listened over the years and sometimes barked back at you, but I also suggest you made all of us who worked with you a whole lot better at what we did. And I do mean all of us. Jim Robson, Jim Cox, Jim Houston, John Shorthouse, Joey Kenward, Rick Ball, and for sure, me. We couldn't have done it without you and would have never wanted to try. So enjoy tonight, knowing this retirement thing is a pretty good gig, and our very best wishes to both you and Leslie. Loving stuff, JP.
From the south of France, J. Paul McConnell on this special night, and did you guys have some memories through the years?
Oh, boy, did we ever, and the great times we had in the football booth. He is one of the great, great broadcasters. I've been so fortunate to work with you guys that call the play-by-play, what a run. And JP's one of my dear friends. We still communicate. We text each other. He's over in France. I love him dearly. Was that ever a nice touch? Thanks a lot.
Well, there's going to be a parade of voices tonight. I don't want to give it away, but that was the first of many. As the Canucks get set to take on the LA Kings here at Rogers Arena, and as we speak, they're introducing and just finishing the introductions of most of the 1970 Canucks team and wearing the vintage uniforms, as the current Canucks will tonight, and Orland Kurtenbach to be introduced soon here. Pat Quinn is already out. He got a nice ovation, but what a nice opening ceremony here to start the anniversary 40th season.
Well, this is what you call tradition. The only thing missing with this franchise is a Stanley Cup, for crying out loud. We all know that. Everything else is here. Great players, great tradition. The greatest fans in the world are right here in this wonderful city that we live in. And I'm so impressed that the ownership of the Vancouver Canucks today, and, you know, it's not just them. The Griffiths family were marvelous owners, too. But for them now to, you know, bring the guys back, keep their tradition going, there's going to be a time, Shorty, I'm going to tell you this right now. I might not see it in my lifetime. There's going to be a time
that when the Canucks go on the road, it's going to be like the Toronto Maple Leafs or the Montreal Canadiens. They're going to go, go Canucks, go. In the other building, mark my words, that's going to happen one day.
There's your first partner being introduced, Jim Robson, coming out with Garth Rizzuto.
Yeah, now you talk about ovation. Everybody loved Jimmy. He set the bar for all of us in this business, and I had the pleasure of breaking in the broadcast booth with a Hall of Famer, a guy who set the bar, your idol as a kid, and Jimmy helped me so much in this business. He truly is one of the best, and I'll tell you what, our run in 94, I'll never forget it, the two of
us.
None
of us will.
And it was exciting, and boy, I'll tell you, I still get goosebumps when they play back the highlights of Robson describing Greg Adams or Trevor Linden going to the bench after Game 6. There were so many great, great moments.
Well, we've never loved noise like we love it tonight. That wasn't bad either. Here's Orland Kurtenbach. He's introduced now.
Orland Kurtenbach.
And with Ron Shooter, who's worked in the dressing room since day one, back to the 60s, his tenure.
Well, you know, Shorty, there's been some great, great hockey players that have worn the C in Canuck history. And the guy who wore the first one right now, Orland Kurtenbach, is maybe as solid a guy as you'll ever want to meet. He is one of the best captains that this franchise has ever had. I broke in my first year. He was the head coach of the Canucks. He only had one assistant, Arnie Brown. And, boy, it was a lousy hockey team. They didn't do very well. He got fired the next year. But I'll tell you what, I'll remember Kurt. He was a big help to me, and what a fierce competitor. And you remember when you were working with me and I had Red Fisher on?
Yeah.
The Hall of Fame a columnist for the Montreal Gazette. Orland Kurtenbach, the best fighter in NHL history. Nobody was tougher. What a compliment.
Well, let's talk about the keys to the game. We have to do that before the Canucks and Kings face off here tonight. They're brought to you by your local Vancouver BMW retailers. Visit your local Vancouver BMW retailer today for a test drive. BMW, the ultimate driving experience. And if they start to announce a captain at any point here, we will break away. But well, they're going to honor Henrik Sedin here for the Hart and Art Ross trophies. That's up on the board. So we may have an announcement to come yet. But let's talk about key number one, which is no opening night jitters.
Well, this is a veteran team right now. This is a team that is knocking on the door. It's good to have the butterflies on opening night. That's very healthy. But you come out and you play like a veteran team. You set the tone. You send the message to the rest of the NHL. The Vancouver Canucks, watch out, because we're not going to be happy until we make it and win the last game that we ever play this season. And you know what that means.
I know
you
what it means.
You raise the Stanley Cup.
Listen to this, the MVP chant down below. They've just,
isn't this beautiful,
recognized Henrik Sedin, because, of course, we haven't seen him in here since he went to Vegas and won both awards, and a standing ovation for the man who's wearing an A right now. Now the LA Kings stand at their bench, too. He's got an A on right now, but we think that might change in the next 5 or 10 minutes.
I told you his reputation is big time now. He's up there with all the greats that have ever played this game. You win a Hart trophy. Boy, I'll tell you, you are some kind of hockey player.
Let's go down to ice level. Orland Kurtenbach's holding something, Tom. It looks like a jersey.
Yeah. From the first captain to the 13th.
Henrik Sedin, would you please join Orland at center ice?
Oh, they all know now.
Henrik Sedin.
Here we go.
Making his way across a blue carpet emblazoned with the 40th anniversary logo here at Rogers Arena. And now it's going to be official as he removes his helmet and his gloves. Off comes the jersey with the A. And you know what's going on now, Tom.
Oh, I sure do. Boy, this is great theater. This is dramatic. This is what sport is all about. What a wonderful touch. Orland Kurtenbach, the first captain of the Canucks, one of their great leaders of all time, giving the sweater to Henrik Sedin, who I think can turn out to be one of the best captains in Canucks history, too. This is a wonderful moment, Shorty.
The LA Kings know what kind of leader he is. He scored that huge goal in Game 4 of the opening round playoffs last year. And now he's going to make his first official duty or perform it as captain, as he'll take a ceremonial face-off here against Dustin Brown, the captain of the Kings, with the puck drop by Orland Kurtenbach. And they're going to use a puck from the first goal scored by the man down there wearing number 4, Barry Wilkins. Awesome.
3-1 hockey game. The Kings won, and of course, Bob Berry, you know Bob. We used to run into him all the time in Anaheim and L.A., now a scout.
Yeah.
And he scored two of those three goals for the L.A. Kings in that win over the Vancouver Canucks in their first ever game played in the National Hockey League.
Well, it's official. Henrik Sedin is the captain. And he will captain this team through what everyone hopes will be a long march that takes them past March, past April, past May. But it's a long journey, and it all begins this evening here.
Hi, it's Scotty Bowman. I'd like to congratulate Tommy on a wonderful career. We go back a long time. We can compare notes probably for the last 30 years. And so congratulations on a great career. And I know all the listeners will be missing you as we are. Well, congratulations, Tom, and enjoy your, I guess it'll be a semi-retirement like myself.
Oh, is that ever nice. Well, the winningest coach in NHL history. Scotty Bowman, what a great guy.
Hey, this isn't just any broadcast.
Oh, man.
We got them all lined up, Tom.
Boy, I'll tell you, you guys are too much. All the work you've done for this night, I'll tell you. Thank you so much. Man, that's neat.
Hey, Tommy, it's Bert, a.k.a. Babe Bud. Just want to congratulate you on an outstanding career. You were not only announcing our games, but we became good friends, and I'm proud of you, and I wish we could have won something together, but all the best to you, and good luck.
Oh, one of my favorites.
Look out, there's a freight train on the loose.
Oh, yeah. Bertuzzi, you're making everybody woozy. Oh, isn't that nice, huh?
Thanks to our buddy Ken Cowell in Detroit for helping out there, getting Todd Bertuzzi.
That was real nice.
Hey, Tom, this is Michael Bublé, and I just want to congratulate you on 30 amazing, illustrious years in this business. We all grew up listening to you, and you colored every single game for us. You made them all better. And you even made the Stinkers better. Thank you on behalf of me and my family and Vancouver. You are an absolute star and a class act. Thanks again.
There were Stinkers?
Oh. Well, I'll tell you, I'm a big fan of this guy, Michael Bublé.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Orland and Pat for taking the time to come up here on my final broadcast. You guys are a big part of my career in Vancouver. Kurt, I wasn't doing this job when you were playing, but my first year in the booth, if you remember, you were the head coach of the Vancouver Canucks. Yeah. And boy, I'll tell you, were you ever great to work with. And I know it wasn't the best team in the world that first year.
No.
But Kurt, you made an impression the first year you came here as a captain, and it's set the tradition. That's what's so beautiful now, 40 years in the league, you being the first captain. And putting that sweater on, what, the 13th captain now in the history. Yeah. That must have been nice for you tonight.
It was tremendous. And again, going back to many years ago for all of us, including Pat, timing is very important in the hockey or in the sports field, right?
Yeah, we know that only too well. I got a big kick out of you when I ran into Kurt at the charity golf tournament at the Jake Milford. You were there too, Pat, and both you guys know about being fired, don't you? And I said to Kurt, I said, you know, I'd like to have done the last year, but they gave me the boot. He said, tell me all about it. I know what it's like. And Pat, I don't have to tell you, you've been in this game. You're around long enough. They finally give you a boot somewhere.
Yeah.
But Pat, I want to thank you for coming up. You know, I've always told everybody that the best hockey man that I have ever worked with in this business is you, my friend. I don't want to embarrass you. I think you're one of the best. Kurt would echo those same sentiments.
And a good person.
And absolutely. I mean, you are a giant of a guy. You're one of the winningest coaches of all time. And do you remember when I leaned over, we're down 3-1 against Calgary in 94, and I used to talk in your ear, you know, we kind of had our thing, and you said, Tommy, if we don't get it done, I'm going to have to blow up this team. I said, hey, They got to win four, maybe, and then boom. It was lightning in a bottle. No. Cardinal in overtime. Yeah. Yeah, Trevor with an overtime. Pavel Bure in double, and you're on your way, Coach. Hey, wasn't that fun?
It was. Well, that's one of the most memorable things for me in the game, and I know why you didn't work, because when Kurt first started playing, electricity hadn't been invented.
That's exactly right.
No radio then.
They invented the wheel though by that time.
Yeah, yeah. But that was such a magic year for us. We knew we had a good team. Our seasonal record wasn't as good as a couple of years prior, but we were learning to win at playoff time. And it didn't look good at 3-1. There's no question about it. And we didn't play badly. In fact, the opening game, Reinhardt was unbelievable in that hockey game.
Yeah, he was class.
Yeah. And, you just had a feeling something was going to happen. Hindsight's great. I can sit here now and say I had that feeling. But, I mean, I had a good feeling. And one of the things that I've picked up or I like about people is attitude. And a lot of times you won't realize what you did for us as far as me concerned and picking me up sometimes when I was down there with whale stuff. And apparently the whales don't do that. I don't know. But attitude is so important, Tommy. That's what you brought to the broadcast. You brought it to us. In our team atmosphere, you were part of our team all the time, and
a
lot of broadcasters don't do that.
You made me feel part of it, Pat. It all starts, and so did Kurt. My very first year always made me feel part of it, and I'll tell you guys, I was telling the fellas today, you know, I cared about this team, and I've respected every guy that's ever put on the sweater. I know I called it the way it is, the way I kind of thought it was, but I'm a straight shooter. You guys both know that. But I'll tell you what, I've always respected a pro athlete to play at the top level. You've got to be a real talent. You paid all the sacrifices. We can all relate to that, and I always understood that. And I just love this team, and I've loved everybody that's worked for it. And you two are just such outstanding athletes, but great, great people. And I'm happy that I've known both of you very, very much.
I appreciate it. That's a mutual feeling, Tom, and to be part of the history of this club has meant a lot to us, too. We kind of were guys that got picked up on, as expansions went on. That first couple of years, we had a team that it had some potential. And sometimes ownership gets screwed up, you know. I mean, and our ownership was screwed up. It was Medicor, and no Canadian wanted to own it at the time.
Right.
So it was kind of a team that nobody wanted. And all of a sudden, the World Hockey come in. Some of our guys left. We had some real character. Those guys you saw on the ice tonight, there was some character in that bunch. Yeah. And we had a chance to grow it. We had this company that was going to get better and better. We had a middle-aged group that was really good, and we had the best leader in the game at the time.
Tell me, what happened?
Well, Pat, you said, I think I lost it because I can't remember too well, so maybe I get punched out like McIntyre did with...
Oh no! Who are you kidding?
Did you see that?
A punch? I mean, we haven't seen a knockout like that, Kurt, since you used to get up against Big Harper at Montreal, and you guys would score, and this guy would throw bombs. Pat.
But you know what, Tom? Just get me in here.
Sure, get in here.
No, Pat hasn't apologized to me because no, hold it now. He's like I'm older now and brittle. But I mean, at that time I was 34 years old and he was like 25.
That's right.
Big Irishman. And there he's picking on this old guy. Now, how bad is that?
Yeah, you better believe it.
You know what? This is an Irishman that is one, maybe a smarter one.
Yeah.
How smart am I to take on the toughest guy in the league?
That's in practice. You guys both know Red Fisher, longtime columnist, Montreal Gazette, the great Canadian teams, and Fisher loves to think he has a pretty good book on everybody. I asked him about Orland Curtin back here recently when I interviewed him. He's 80-some-odd years old now, and he said, the toughest, bar none, of anybody I ever saw at the National Hockey League level, Orland Curtin back. The toughest. And he never looked for a fight, did he?
No, but...
But he finished them.
Oh, yeah. But you know what?
Kurt? You know what? I don't want to leave with everybody thinking that all you did was throw a punt. This guy could play.
His point of game, man.
The knee doesn't go out, I remember it well. I mean, this guy now was only big and tough and defended his teammates. But the guy could play. He was a wonderful hockey player.
He can't run, though.
Well, who can?
Tell the story, Pat.
We're playing in Oakland and had a couple of pops at after the game, so we're heading back to the hotel, and so sort of a bet gets laid out.
Yeah, but he's telling me about all this playing football and how what a good runner he was and so on. So I looked at the guy and I said, he's 220 pounds. His legs are twice as big as my waist. I could take him. We start off. We'll race to the light standard. Well, Pat's there waiting for me. He was gone, and he was waiting.
I believe it. You know, hey, listen, he gave me a little of that the other day when I was up at Capilano, and he came in. He said, my golf game is so bad. He said, Mickey McDowell said, you know what, Pat? He said, why don't you take 2 weeks off and then quit? And so he shoots 51 on the front nine. I'm starting to feel sorry for him. So I said, let's talk hockey. Meantime, I was playing pretty good on the front. In fact, I was smacking the ball pretty good. Well, let me tell you what happened. I started to talk hockey. He started to play golf. He shot 39 on the back and took all the money.
Oh, he didn't tell me that.
39, a 22 handicap.
He was whining about those 51.
Oh, this guy, I'll tell you, you got to get up early in the morning to beat the Quinnmeister.
I'll tell you, Tom. Just quickly. As players that we finish here and we, you know, retire and watching, and I got to say, for alumni and for on a personal basis, I am so proud of Pat and Dale for what they've accomplished in the hockey world.
Oh yes.
And you know what? They haven't changed their spots. They haven't. They're still. Their word is their honor, and so on. So, Pat.
Yeah, that's a pretty nice compliment, Pat. That when you have your teammates speak like that of you. I mean, well, that's why I say, Kurt, and you're in that class too. You guys are, I don't know, I don't want to sound like we're getting old and we say, well, they don't make them like they used to, guys. But there's young ones now. They're entertaining us. We enjoy watching them play.
Yeah.
And let's hope that maybe this is the year, hey, guys, the 40th year.
Fingers crossed. Yeah.
I know that's something that you've always wanted to do as a coach, too.
Darn right. It's the only one I'm missing, Tommy.
I'm missing it, too.
Guys, I've asked the league to postpone the game until we're done talking here, but they won't listen. I hate what you've done, too. I don't know how I do an intermission the rest of the season after the one we do here in game number one. But
We're making you work all night, Tom, but it sounds like it's worth it.
You know what, Shorty? That wasn't work. Two guys that I've had the highest respect for so many years, Orland Kurtenbach, Pat Quinn, what a great coach, a great general manager, a great president, one of the favorite. Well, they're both favorites of Vancouver hockey fans in this city and always will be. And just to hear these two guys reminisce here, and boy, we had some fun together. I really enjoyed that. What a send-off this is turning out to be for me. I know I sound repetitious, but I'm blown away by all this.
Just need the hockey team to come through for you. No goals in this game.
They will. They're going to come through.
They're on their feet at GM Place, and they're saluting the man next to me. And Alain Vigneault clapping his hands at the bench. Tommy, a standing ovation. You deserve it, buddy. They're playing my way, buddy.
Oh, my God. This is unbelievable. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you. My bottom of my heart. This is just incredible. Wow. I'll tell you, they love their hockey, don't they? These are the greatest fans in the world, Jordy. I'm shaking up here right now. I don't know why. That was so nice of the hockey club to do that.
You deserve it, buddy. 33 years in the booth, Tom Larscheid, and so many of these people, you look at the different generations and the ages of the people that you've affected, and and inspired, and it goes right from the people who've been listening since day one to the kids who haven't been listening but for the last 5 years. And you saw that as this building came together as one. And you don't have to say anything else, buddy. Just enjoy it. I mean, you have to talk at some point tonight.
I know.
Tom, it's Steve Tambellini. I know you're doing your last game for the Vancouver Canucks broadcast. And to me, I'm just so happy that I had a chance to get to know you as a player, as a manager, And I can say that I've never met anyone that had more enthusiasm, more passion, more feel for really what the fans wanted and what the players wanted. You did an outstanding job, Tom, and I just want to say good luck. I value our relationship and wish you and Leslie all the very, very best.
Oh, boy, is that nice. Steve is really a top-notch guy. Was he ever happy the other night? Wasn't he sure? He is the general manager of the Edmonton Oilers. All those young guns they have in there, boy, can they skate and can they move? And I went up and talked to his son today, too, Jeff Tamry, yeah. Who's now a Vancouver Canuck, and told him how much I thought of his father.
Jeff not in the lineup tonight. Canucks are shorthanded again, fourth straight time in the game, an elbowing call to Edler for the open ice hit on Kyle Clifford.
Hey, Tom, it's Jim Houston. Remember me? Tom, I'd like to say thanks for all of these great years you've put in as a real honest, passionate, analytical voice of the Canucks, and let's not forget the BC Lions. You know, thinking that you've really joined an elite and august group of great personalities and chroniclers of Vancouver sports history. In fact, you're now a big part of it. So thanks a lot for all of the years and for a few laughs along the way too, Tom. And I hope your retirement is anything but murder.
Oh, one of my esteemed colleagues, I'll tell you. And the first one, the guy who set the bar. But first of all, let me acknowledge Jim Houston. That was just wonderful. Yeah. And you know what, guys? When it comes to phrasing, I think of Jim Houston like Frank Sinatra, the phrase of song. His phrasing is just impeccable.
Oh, he's great. He is great. And now he's in the center of the universe every Saturday. Hey, I mean, Shorty thinks he's got the best job in the world, but yeah. How would you like to do just Saturday nights in Toronto? You know, or coast to coast.
Look, Shorty salivated.
But he earns it. Yeah, he is very good. But, you know, this is an amazing group. I was just thinking about Jim Houston and Shorty and Rick. I mean, and you talked about it on your five-hour special or whatever it was yesterday. And they'll repeat it tomorrow if you miss it. And I'm saying about the quality of the play-by-play, yeah. Guys. This city... Radio, too, is big in hockey here, more than most markets, and the quality of the broadcast.
You know why, though,
excellent.
Don't you? Because you started it.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
you did.
No,
the
Jim,
right place.
You set the bar.
Well, you're right place at the right time, you know, and that was part of it. And it's great tonight being up there in the suite up there with all the old 1970 guys, and they're having a terrific time. The Canucks have done a great job. They gave them a kit, a beautiful box with the 40 logo on it. Inside there's the 40 book, and there's a copy of the original, mind you, it's a reprint, but of the original program from day one, game one. Team picture, and the guys, Rosie's going over getting guys' autographs, Rosie Paymont, and all these guys. So it's a wonderful night, and it's a heck of a hockey game. I mean, and this game needed a goal, so they have about a 10-minute standing ovation for Larscheid. And... even the guys around over there were standing, and some of them that were the 1970 team say, who are they standing for that old ball guy up there? And is this game need a goal? What happened? They get a goal. It's a happy
hey,
game.
Jim, tell us about that 70s team. I mean, you were there. You covered these guys. Kurt and Pat Quinn, two original members, were up here.
They
did. I was so happy to see them. Tell us what kind of impact they made to that team.
Well, this was a tough team. I mean, they were tough to play against. This was new expansion. Everybody thought, oh, they're only going to win a half a dozen games. At Christmas time, they're in fourth place in a 17 division. And at Christmas time, one of the highest scoring lines in the league is Orland Kurtenback, Murray Hall, and Wayne Mackey. I mean, they all thought Kurt was a fourth liner or something, but he was getting a chance to play. And then Kurt gets hurt December 23rd. But they still were a competitive team. With a lot of character. I mean, the guys that came up to visit with you, I mean, how much character are you going to get in a room with Kurtenbach and Quinn? So, and you know, Dale Talon. I'm glad the crowd cheered tonight. I'm standing down the ice and we're coming out, and Dale says, do you think they'll boo me, he said. And I said, I'll bet a few of them do, you know? But they didn't. They cheered.
Yeah.
56 points as a 19-year-old rookie. Played three positions. He was a good hockey player. And he was thrilled to hear that reaction. He said, you know, in the Chicago tonight, they're putting up the banner and all this is going on. And he was really pleased. They didn't boo. They cheered. And that's the way it should be.
Well, they asked me to come in here and introduce the guest today. it's kind of pointless, I think, isn't it? We recognize that voice, obviously.
Oh, yeah, Rick and I did a game in Kelowna one night.
We did Jim Robson.
Yeah.
Tommy, you talked about Jim being the gold standard and how many of the young broadcasters in this city listen to him, and you, for that matter. I mean, I was thinking about this today. Both you guys, you know, I love listening to you as a fan. I had the chance to do one game with Jim Robson my first year doing junior hockey game. It was me and Brad Fay, who works at Sportsnet, and Jim sat between us. It was a dream come true. And obviously, I love working with you as well, Tommy, even more than listening. And even more than that, just getting to know you as a person. It's been a great couple of years. I didn't have a run like Shorty did, or obviously Jim, or even Jim Houston, but it was a real special 2 years to do hockey with you and travel around and experience the National Hockey League circuit. With you as a colleague and a friend. And I have one of my new favorite memories in this building is that standing ovation you got after the tribute tonight. That was something special.
That was great. Yeah, it really was.
Well, I was moved by it, guys. Thank you. Thank you very much. And Jim, you know, I tell everybody, you went through the growing pains with me. Let's be honest about it.
Yeah, let's be honest. When people today, I get called today again about, I was on the radio again this morning. I keep waiting to get asked. But I get asked once in a while now. And I said, and I mean this sincerely, the best team of broadcasters, and all due respect to you, Rick, are these two guys.
I would agree.
Larscheid and Shorthouse together were the best team in the booth the Canucks have had. You and I did a lot of good games together.
Yes, we did.
But we know how rough it was at the start.
For sure.
We used to have meetings because I said, Tom, we got to have a pregame meeting. and so we'd get all things. I said, I'll do the officials, you do the goalies. Okay, I'll do the Vancouver scratches, you do the visiting scratches. And we'd have these meetings like television. And then the meeting started to get shorter and shorter. And after about a year and a half, Tom came in one night and says, do we need these meetings anymore? I said, no, we don't. But that's what we had to do. Because
I didn't know what to do. You had to teach me.
Well, I was an old plow horse that came in, worked alone. I always did it stripped. See, Tom's an entertainer. I was a guy who described it. I didn't think about entertaining. I just let the game entertain. If the game didn't, well, we had problems. But Tom entertained.
Absolutely.
And that was... So we had to put that together, and it took a while.
What did you think?
You're entertaining
when,
right now.
No, what did you think when this football guy came over to do hockey? I mean, how much of a shock to the system
was
that?
It's sports. I mean, people say, that should bother me. People say, oh, Tom Larscheid, he never played hockey. I said, I never played hockey. And they said, how can you be a hockey announcer? I said, I know a lot of doctors that delivered babies and never had one. I mean, we describe what happened.
Exactly.
Do I get a chance to tell one of the best intermissions?
No, just before you do, I want to show you something that's ironic, you guys, real quickly. When I was flown up here, the first visit to Canada ever was to sign with the BC Lions.
61 Grey Cup.
And it's a 1961 Grey Cup. And you know who the first media member, I mean broadcaster or print guy or anything that I was introduced to? Jim Robson.
Wow.
And would you believe, this was in 1961.
Yeah.
And 16 years later, he and I are working in the hockey booth
together. He ran right past me to the bar. These four guys came up from U.S. colleges. They were wooing this guy because he was an NFL draft.
Absolutely.
Larscheid was a great football player, no question. And he was brought up there they were trying to get him to sign with the Lions. And they had a lot of fun that weekend. And I happened to be because I was doing football in.
Yes, you were.
Although I didn't know a heck of a lot about these guys coming up. I said, who's this Larscheid? You know, he's a back. I said, he's a little bit short. But then you look at the stats. Number two in the United States in total offense. I mean, a great player. Retired his number there at Utah State.
Absolutely.
Utah State's not doing too well, Tom. You better come out of retirement down there.
Oh, I know. It's been some lean years, hasn't it?
Yeah.
I want to hear the intermission story.
Yeah. All right. All kinds of stuff on Tom's stories. But this one, we're in Long Island, New York, working in the old Nassau Coliseum before they put the press box in. And it's still a bad rink, right? But it was even worse then. We're up at the back. Let's see. Tom comes, and he had great intermissions. As you mentioned the other day, he likes to sputter guys up, bring those GMs along, and then zing! Is it right you're going to trade your top defenseman to somebody for two picks or something? And the guy says, blah, blah, blah. And then the next day he wants to see it in the paper that the guy on the radio said this. But anyway... He comes to me and says, we're going to have a great intermission. I got this Russian hockey star.
Oh, this is funny.
He's with the Russian national team, and he's going to play against the Rangers when the U.S. or the Russian and the NHL were playing games. So I said, yeah, okay. And yeah, he's on the national team. I said, does he speak English? He said, well, he's got an interpreter with him. The media guy's going to do it with him. I said, oh, that'll be okay, yeah. So now they start the intermission. And Larscheid's got the headset on. So I get to listen to the headset because he's got a handheld with two guests. Well, you imagine what's going to happen now, eh? He goes to a question about, they tell us about how you feel about playing National Hockey League teams. And then the interpreter grabs the mic and goes, yakety boogity, I can't. And he goes on and on, see? 30 seconds or whatever. And then he goes and holds the mic, and then the Russian player goes, ah, and it goes on another 34 seconds. And then it comes to the back of the interpreter. Interpreter says, he's happy to be here. That went on for about 8 or 9 minutes.
When you cut it out, you're killing me.
And then finally, Tom knew it wasn't going anywhere. So he cut it off, and we had to pad for 3 minutes at the end of the intermission because he got rid of the Russians.
I was struggling. I was looking for help.
Yeah.
That was a great classic intermission.
It's a great story, but that was actually Polish. Just, you know.
Oh, that's why I didn't understand.
Well, it's...
Hey, you know what? Seriously, you guys, he went through the growing pains, but Jimmy, I'm so happy you're part of this night with me because... without you accepting me in the booth, come on, at it for us to go, I wouldn't be here tonight, and I thank you for that.
Well, you know what I do is at the Jake Milford Golf Tournament this year, Tom's moaning about shooting an 82, and I'm shooting 105. But anyway, we have a really good visit. Just the two of us, and nobody else around, and we talked a lot about the job and the future and all this, and I really enjoyed that, Tom.
I did too, Jim.
Yeah.
I did too.
I wish Leslie was here tonight to hear the scene of the ovation.
She wants to listen. She wanted to listen tonight. Yeah. She's home right now. Say hello to her.
I wish you'd been here to see the reaction in the building. This is a magic night, and it's a great game, and it's terrific to be here tonight.
Hey, do you know what it means to all of us in here, these broadcasters that are looking at you right now, to be sitting in the Jim Robson gondola?
Hey, they got a new sign. It looks more permanent than the last one.
Hey, isn't that nice?
It doesn't say memorial.
You're such a big part of this hockey scene and the tradition here, Jim.
Oh, that's good.
And I said to people, you and I haven't seen a lot of each other socially lately, but we can bump into each other. We don't see each other for a year, maybe 6 months or a year and a half, and we pick up like old times, the respect we both have for each other.
I could never stay up as late enough to stay out with you.
In those days. In those days. I don't anymore, you know.
Oh, well, we're both getting up there now. Yeah.
I hate to cut this off. Just keep going.
Okay.
Yeah. Isn't he a treat, you guys?
Thanks,
Jim.
Both of
you
guys.
Jim, seriously.
It's a two-way street.
It's great having you, Jim.
What a good night tonight.
Come up and help me close?
You'll feel down tomorrow.
I know. But I'm
you'll puff right back up again.
Jim, I'm 3,000 feet in the air without a propeller right now.
Get the parachute.
I know. I'll need it.
Jim Robson, Tom Larscheid. That was After 40 Minutes, brought to you by Mitsubishi. Canucks lead the Kings 1-0.
Canucks play here. Team 1040.
Hi, Tom. This is Gary Bettman. I just wanted to congratulate you on over 30 years of broadcasting Canucks games. Enjoy your retirement, and thanks for all you've done.
You've said there's no one who dodged your questions better through the years, huh?
Oh, no, this guy, he's a smoothie, I'll tell you. I tried, didn't I, Shorty, three or four times to get to the commissioner and ask, and I'll tell you, he handled me like I was a rookie. You know, I really enjoyed interviewing him, Trevor Linden's day. You know, when he came here to celebrate Trevor's retirement and retirement of his jersey, as you know. And I had a chance to interview the commissioner again to season ticket holders and that type of thing. But this guy, he's smooth on his feet. But isn't that nice of him? That was really neat.
Thank you to the commissioner. Thank you to Greg Baldinger for helping facilitate that.
Do you think he remembers what I look like?
Yeah, I do. I do.
Okay.
Hi, Thomas. Who would have ever thought that a chance encounter with you back in 1967 while you were trying to rehab your knee in the Mark Club in Vancouver would turn into a great lifetime friendship? Thank you on behalf of everybody, especially the people of Vancouver, for all that you've done. You're the greatest. All my very best. Love, Jim.
Your old pal, Jim Gregory.
Yeah, one of my dear friends, Shorty, as you well know. Jim Gregory, boy, I'll tell you, Hall of Famer and respected by everybody in the hockey business and a dear, dear friend of mine. I love him so much. He's a great, great guy.
Hi, Tommy. This is Jack McElhargy. I just want to wish you all the best. What a great career you had. I was here when you started, and I'm very happy I'll be here for your last game. Hockey's going to miss you, Tommy. You've done a great job, and you're a great guy. Thanks a lot.
Well, you've seen him in person. Now you get to hear him on tape. Jack McElhargy.
He's gone down as one of the favorite Canucks of all time. Boy, you talk about a guy that was a great team player, and his teammates just loved him. And, boy, did he cover everybody's back when he played.
It's a power play.
Well, it was a great hockey game tonight, and it's not the kind of start that the Canucks wanted to have, the 40th anniversary of this franchise. These L.A. Kings, who surprised everybody last year, came in and just played the Canucks right to the end. They got a big goal from Williams late in the third period, Shorty, and then you thought, well, this could go the other way. And as it turns out, it went all the way to a shootout, and the L.A. Kings were able to win it. It's unfortunate. Good hockey game. What else can I say? I'm sorry that the hockey club didn't win this one. But they did pick up a point.
They got a point. They're on pace for 82. That won't do it, but it could be a valuable one when all is said and done. This is the thing about shootouts. I'm in favor of. I like them. They're just so much better when the home team wins.
Oh, it is.
It's just a funeral march.
Yeah, it is. Everybody sags. It's always been like that in any building that you're in. When you win the shootout, it's they're over the moon. They really are.
And I'm ready to cry.
No.
We'll get there in a moment. Lots of things to take out of this game that I think, I think Roberto Luongo, you talked about the rebound on the time goal in the third period, but really, you can hardly say, well, that's a bad goal.
No,
he was very good in this hockey.
He was outstanding. And so was Jonathan Quick.
Yeah.
Jonathan Quick
picked up where they left off,
didn't they? They did. These two goalies, when they played in the playoffs last year, and, this is going to turn out to, I think, be a great competition because this is a better LA team than we've seen in many years. And we know the Canucks are going to be very good this year. I saw a lot of good things from the Canucks tonight. I really did.
Anyone else in particular?
Well, I thought Aerhoff had a fabulous game tonight. We certainly considered him as a star. The two goaltenders really, as it turned out, because of the kind of game it was, had to be in the three-star selection. For the most part, I like Hamhuis and I like Ballard. I think they're two very good additions. Manny Malhotra, I think, is going to be a lot better as the season goes on. Raffi Torre showed some signs. I hope that he can bring a little bit more bite to his play and be a finisher. But certainly it's all there for this to be a very good hockey team. And I'm going to really be interested to see their progress throughout the year. So you better entertain me a little bit. I've enjoyed so much being at your side here. Now I get to listen to you and watch you on television. So all the best. And to the Vancouver Canucks, boy, I'll tell you, I like this hockey team. And I'm still going to be rooting for them until the good guy upstairs says, that's it, okay?
We've had quite a night, haven't we?
Yeah, well...
We've had a parade of friends and colleagues, and both in person and on tape, and we wanted to try to make this special for you. I was so pleased that you wanted to come back and do this one game. And what I'm going to do here is just say a couple of words, and then I'm going to just leave the floor to you, buddy. And I just want to thank you. I can't believe it's been 12 years.
Yeah.
It seems like yesterday I sat down for my first game with you, and the one thing I will take away from our partnership and our friendship, well, two things I'll take away. Number one is teamwork. We had unbelievable teamwork, and half of it people couldn't see. Well, they couldn't see any of it because it was on radio. But half of it they couldn't hear because it was things behind the scenes, gestures, helping each other out, making sure we got it as right as we could. And I want to thank you for that, and I want to thank you for the laughs because I have never laughed so hard so regularly in my life as I have over the past 12 years. And sometimes it hurt. We laughed so hard. It's been a wonderful ride. So thank you, Tom. Thank you on behalf of everybody. And I'm going back to when I wasn't working, when I was listening. And you've meant so much to this community, to this province, to this hockey team,
I think over the course of 33 years, you can say that nobody has done more to sell hockey in this city than you have. And I thank you on behalf of everybody, but especially on behalf of me. So thank you for a great night, and best of luck. You and Leslie, you have a wonderful companion. And you guys, I can't wait to hear of your exploits. I know you're going on a cruise soon, and I know there's going to be lots of fun stuff after that. So have a great time, Tom. And thank you for 33 amazing years.
Well, Shorty, thank you for 12 years. It's been so much fun to be at your side. It's been a privilege. It really has. And I've said to a lot of people, whoever fills my seat, and it's going to be Dave Tomlinson, and he's going to enjoy sitting next to you, too. You're a real pro. I've had more fun in 12 years with you than anybody. As Jim Robson said, the chemistry was there. And I felt it the day you came in the booth. And I think the fans felt it, too. We enjoyed it. We love the game of hockey. We love this team that we cover. The good, the bad, and the ugly. All of it, you put it all in. It's still the greatest game in the world. And, you know, I leave now with nothing but just great, great memories. It's just unbelievable. I know Leslie better get ready for me when I get home because I'm going to lose it by the time I get there. But she'll give me a big hug. But speaking of hugs, I want to thank everybody at Rogers Arena here tonight that made me feel so good. I wish I could give them all a hug right now, but if they're listening, I thank each and every one of them because they gave me the biggest hug a broadcaster could ever have. The ovation was just tremendous and unexpected. You led me into this, Shorty. You know, they say the best retirement speech is one that is short, but certainly gracious. And I don't know if I can be short just yet because I have so many people to thank, but I am gracious. And if you'll just let me go here for a minute, I jotted down a couple things, but it's just all from the heart and it's off the top of my chest. But I want to thank our radio station, Team 1040. And I want to thank the Vancouver Canucks Hockey Club, today's hockey club, the management, and everybody else for allowing me to do one more game, to be able to come in here and go out the right way. And that's doing what I've loved to do for all these years. Every time I came into the booth, the rush was on, and you guys, I think, felt it. I always felt like I could pick everybody up, and we tried to pick up the listeners, too, with our commentary. And Shorty, you were as much a part of this as were all the other guys. So I really want to begin this farewell and my thank yous to the radio station who treated me first class and also to the Vancouver Canucks. But I have to begin by the guy who had the courage and the conviction to put me in the broadcast booth with Hall of Famer Jim Robson. You know, a football player background and then thrown in with a guy who went on to be a National Hockey League Hall of Fame broadcaster. He's an institution. He set the bar for you. He set the bar for Jim Houston. He set the bar for everybody. And as I said to him, it was so nice to have him here in the second period that he had to go through the growing pains with me. You know, I was forced on him. He didn't ask for me. But somehow we made it work. And I really think well, I'll get to that in a minute. But without Ted Smith backing me and saying, hey, listen, this is going to be your color guy. You make it work. Boy, when you have that kind of backing from management, this is what can happen. You can go all the way. People didn't think I'd last 3 weeks. I've lasted 33 years. So, Ted Smith, I know you're listening tonight. You sent me an email, and thank you so much. I want to move then to the Canuck fans and the listeners, because if we didn't have the listeners and we didn't have the fans, none of us would be working. And, you know, I want to thank all the listeners who allowed us to come into their homes and their condos and their cars. You know, I tried to always say what you were thinking. I thought I was an extension of the fans. I really felt that was my role. I wanted to broadcast this great game with passion, enthusiasm, and flair. But I also never forgot that we're in the entertainment business. I wanted people to laugh. I wanted people to get excited. I always felt it was a compliment when I would run into people and they'd say, boy, Larscheid, you really got excited last night in the booth. You know what? I knew I excited them. They didn't want to admit they were excited, but they were. And that's really what it's all about. And I hope I did that for people, that they enjoyed the game. And I worked with the greatest broadcasters in the world, and I'll get to that. Next, I mean, I can't leave without thanking all the Canuck teams that I've covered since 1977. I want to thank, obviously, all the players, all the coaches, the managers, the scouts, the trainers. I'm going to get to the trainers. I can't name everybody, but I've always respected everybody that has ever put on the Canuck sweater. Every player. Yeah, I criticized them, and I got upset, and, you know, I called it the way it was. But I'd like to think that I always did it gracefully. And I think all the players that ever got to know me and the ones who've come in the booth and I've had a big hug with tonight, they did. They knew I wanted them to be successful. And I tried to help them get there. You know, Shorty, the respect that I've had for the trainers. I'm going to name them because if people only really understood how important a training staff is to a hockey team, they are so important. They don't show in the wins and losses and goals and assists, but they make the atmosphere right for the players. And we've got the best in Vancouver. And I want to start, you know, with the late Kenny Flager. You guys didn't know him. Boy, what a guy. The old-timers will tell you. The late Larry Ashley. All these guys were so good to me. And then this one, Patty O'Neill, Mike Bernstein, John Sanderson, Jamie Hendricks, Red Hamilton, Roger Takahashi, and Dave Zarn. I want to mention those guys because they don't get the kind of mention, but they meant a lot to me. And I want to thank them for that. And the doctors, you know, I can't name everybody, but I have to acknowledge Sid Sherd, the chiropractor, who's been a great friend of mine all these years and pops all the muscles for these players and has kept me going, too, over the years when I haven't felt too good. And Dr. Bill Regan, too, who's recently is trying to keep me going as a 70-year-old. But, you know, I have a huge thank you I have to address to my colleagues. The guys in the media, our competitors. I can't name all the guys, but they know that I've thanked them all. I've been so blown away by the love and the friendship that's been directed to me from the people that I work with in the print media, electronic media. It's just so good to know that they liked you being around. Let's just put it that way. But I like being around them too, and they all know who they are. And I thank all of you, and I thank you, most of you in person. That brings me to the broadcasters. I've worked with the greatest broadcasters. Jim Robson said it. There's no city in the National Hockey League that has better radio broadcasters than the Vancouver Canucks have had in their history. You know, I talked to Jim, and if people have listened through the entire broadcast, I made my sentiments known to him. He set the bar for everybody. He taught us how to make a summary, a running summary during the game. We're all doing it now. Shorty was 10 years old, underneath his blanket, practicing play-by-play to be like Jim Robson. You know, Jim Robson deserves such a pat on the back from me because those were the growing pains. I really didn't know what the hell I was doing when I first got in the booth, but I knew I had enough chutzpah and a shtick, you know, that I could kind of get through it and try to be entertained. But as I got to know the game and everything else, I really think our work in 1994 when the Canucks went all the way to the Stanley Cup was the best work that that I've ever done as a broadcaster in this hockey booth. And the reason being is because it was the greatest run, the greatest team. And if you can't get up and give the public the very best when the team is out there laying it on the line like they did in 94, I can't go through all that right now. People were there. They witnessed it. That was a real highlight for us. And I thank Jim for that. And then came Jim Houston. And, you know, I mentioned Jim Houston, when it comes to play-by-play, his phrasing, it's impeccable. It really is. It's an unbelievable talent. You know, Frank Sinatra had that when he sang a song. You know, that's what Jim Houston has. And he's a pro. He's now moved on. He's the number one guy in Hockey Night in Canada. I mean, this is the kind of strength that I've been working with. Shorty, I'm going to wait for you for a minute if I can. Rick Ball. Rick Ball, you talk about a great broadcaster, football, and now in the hockey booth, and he loves doing it, and what a professional he is, and what a treat to work with. Dan Russell always wanted to come in here and do some games, and Shorty, when Chris was going to have the baby, Will was on his way, he got his chance to sit with me, and I enjoyed that too, and he was a real pro. And J.P. McConnell. I mean, I had so many great years in football with my good buddy Jay Paul. And he slid in the chair, too, from time to time and had to do play-by-play with me on hockey. And he's a first-class guy, and I really want to thank him. I mean, I worked with the best. But, Shorty, this is the toughest part for me because, you know, it's really funny. You know, I think back... you know, Stackhouse, that's the funniest line ever. And you end up sitting next to me the next year. And we just, it was like magic. It was like the best fitting suit from Madison Menswear. The minute they put it on us, boy, they said, hey, that's it. That's A1. And it has been so much fun. But you know what? You've made me young. You've kept me young. The fire is still in my belly. All the laughs. But it's the support that you have given me. And you've enhanced my work, and the city, and even Jim Robson called it the way it is. There's never been a better team than you and I, Shorty. And I feel privileged to be part of it with you, and I know you feel the same way. It's been just a fantastic run. And you know what? When I thought about this last game, you're the reason I wanted to do it. Not for me, not for anybody else. I wanted to do it with you one time and go out the right way. And I am. And to everybody that tuned in tonight for my final broadcast, and there's going to be lots of good ones down the road, and I want to say this too. The guy that's going to sit in my chair, Dave Tomlinson, he is a first-class guy, and he's going to be a real pro. And he's got his style, and you're going to come to love it. And I mean that sincerely, and I wish Dave nothing but the very best. Is he's going to provide excellent color on the broadcast for Canucks hockey for many years to come, I hope. And I want to wish him the very, very best. But to all of you who have listened to the broadcast tonight, I hope you enjoyed it. It's something I'll never forget. I've been so high, and to see all old friends and Mike Whittingham, I got to thank you, all the producers we've had over the years. I thank all the guys behind the scene. But Mike and Shorty, what you two guys did for me tonight is just unbelievable. The work you put in to make this an evening that I'll never forget. This is a send-off that people just don't get in the real world. They don't. And you guys have made this so special for me. Boy, I hate to think that if I was in Canton, I just retired on my own. I don't know. I mean, this has been unbelievable. Anyway, I want people to laugh a little bit. My last line, I think I can say, and I've got it together here right now. I think the best way to end this is everyone who listened tonight, everybody that was in the arena tonight, Rogers Arena, I want to just say one thing. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. I want to give you all a big hug. And I want to just say one more thing. I want this Vancouver Canuck team to go on and win the Stanley Cup for this city. And I know it's going to happen. And I wish this coaching staff and these players that they're the very best as we break out the champagne here. And we really should. But to all of you who listened tonight and all of you that just tuned in now, thanks so much for all the support you've given me. And all I can say is goodbye. And good night. And just one more thing to make you smile. Good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are. What do you think, Shorty?
That's awesome.
We'll see you, buddy. Goodbye, everybody.
Cheers to Tom. You can speak, everybody.
Hey, Tom! All right,
now I got one more thing. Just to end it. One of my favorite things in life was being on the plane and playing the old clips and cracking you up.
Yeah.
And I kept them for a reason. So this is my parting gift to you. I'm not the world's best editor, but I did my best. So thank you, and best of luck. And we'll leave you with this. Okay, buddy?
Thanks, Shorty.
Cut ties the game with 5.7 seconds remaining in Game 7. does not work. Of course prayer works.
How lovely it was. Thanks for the memory.
Drop pass, Naslin. Wrist shot, sir.
Yes!
Marcus Naslin has made it 4-2 Vancouver.
The Canucks have just kicked down the door in Detroit.
How lovely it was. We who could laugh over big things.
Well, we're out of breath up here in the broadcast booth. You know, fans, when you come to GM Place, they have that 50-50 draw.
Leslie?
Chris, you're not going to believe this, but we won it.
Oh, is that exciting or what?
Thanks for the memory.
Look out, there's a freight train on the loose, baby. And everybody in the building knows Babe has tied the record. Get on the telephone. I'm not kidding you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the memory.
How can you give up a breakaway at this stage of the hockey game?
And here come the Bruins again. Another breakaway. Joel Thornton in on Kluche. Scores!
I cannot believe it. That is just unforgivable.
Thanks for the memory.
Henrik and Daniel and Carter. Daniel, Henrik and Carter. That's about how it goes. They should make up a song like that.
No tears, no fuss. Hooray for us.
Linden's got a score. He scores here. He can run for mayor. In on Sabourin. Linden scores. He'll win. He can run for mayor. And he'll get elected too.
Trevor Linden, he has the fans in an uproar here.
Awfully glad I met you. Cheerio, toodaloo. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are.
Go to Kurt in line three. Kurt, go ahead.
Hello there. It's the same scenario. Tom Larscheid, class act, and I was glad I could listen to him. Very fine fella. Let's just leave it at that.
Kurt, thanks for the call. Appreciate it. Ron, go ahead. Ron, you're on the Team 1040 and the Canucks Radio Network.
Well, I'm disappointed that Mike Gillis asked 1040 to fire Tom Larscheid based on some of his comments, because Tommy's been honest throughout the years. But I have a suggestion that maybe if the Canucks make the Stanley Cup final that we all hope we do, that we could bring Tommy back as a guest for the finals and the final, and let him join the rest of the crew, and that would be really neat.
Ron, thanks for the call. It's a good suggestion. If they start to show signs that they're getting close, I'll be happy to broach that. I'll be happy to bring that up as a three-man booth for the Stanley Cup final. You tend to ramp things up in the playoffs, so I think it's a fine suggestion. Well done. John and Poco, go ahead. John, you're on the Team 1040.
Yeah, I just want to say that it was an extraordinarily bittersweet night. Tom and all of the people in that building giving him his just desserts. And an absolute pox on the Canucks for what they've done in an effort to get rid of Tom. And unfortunately, Team 1040 going right along with it. I think it's a disgrace, and I think this city is losing one of its great treasures, and we have become just another corporate joke. Unfortunately, Tom, you got sucked in by a team that pretends that they want the best for the public, but in fact, all they really want is everybody to walk around and glad hand them, and Mike Gillis in particular, shame on you.
John and Pogovic. Lots more of the Quiznos post-game show ahead. Your calls are welcome. 280-TEAM, 280-8326, star team on your cell phone. Get a hold of us anytime. The new Wireless Wave in-game inbox is there for you. You can text us at 104040, email us live at teamradio.ca. All brought to you by Wireless Wave, your Bell experts. Visit them today at a mall near you. Wireless Wave, love the phone. We'll come back with more of your reaction to the game, to the final game for Tommy, head coach Alain Vigneault, and more. You got it on the Quiznos post-game show.
One game
for Tommy's last game.
I know.
You're that close.
Yeah. But I'll tell you what. I've been one of the selected few that's had the real honor and pleasure to work in the Canucks play-by-play seat alongside Tom Larscheid over the past 2 years. What a great guy. We all know what he's like on the air. And believe me, there's a lot of fans that have missed out to see what this guy is like when he's not on the microphone. And he's a true gentleman in every sense of the word. This was... what a send-off for him. That reaction that the radio listener didn't hear...
Inside the building. Unbelievable.
...during the second TV timeout in the second period was just golden. Yeah. And nothing... It was just a nice video tribute. No words were said. Thanks, Tommy. There was no public address announcement needed. Just some good old thanks for the memories, music in the background, and...
standing over by everybody, including Alain Vigneault, who clapped.
Applauding on the bench. And that was a great, great sign and a gesture from the Vancouver bench boss. And... we're already hearing it from people on the phone board tonight. This is a guy that will not soon be missed. He's certainly a class act, and as a broadcaster in this market, not just as a Canucks broadcaster, and a broadcaster to boot in all different sports, he certainly goes down as one of the greatest ever in this city.
Hi, I agree. It was a very good game tonight, very physical. And one thing to note, I guess, with the Tommy Larscheid tribute, it would have probably gone on for many, many more minutes, but they started the game. The referees dropped the puck and kind of had to shut us up. I was at the game, and I thought Tommy deserved every clap that he heard, and he went out gracefully. That was great. The one disappointing thing that I remember for the season is probably the stupid, stupid interference penalty Kessler got right as he was just about stepping into the bench that caused the tying goal and stole away the shutout and the 2 points. I mean, the guy's brought here for many things, I guess, but giving a game up in the last 3 minutes is not one of them, and he should be scoring goals. He had one shot on goal tonight, one hit, and one block shot, and a blown penalty that I think cost us 2 points.
Dave, thanks for the call. This is going to sound like a bigger indictment of Ryan Kessler than I mean it to be, because I don't think he was that off tonight. That is the kind of thing that means that he's not the captain right now. I mean, he's still a bit of an agitator. He's still got agitator in him. He hasn't exactly extracted all of it out of his blood yet, and that's probably a good thing for the Vancouver Canucks. Yes, took a bad penalty tonight. Might have cost them a single point. It's true. A lot of nights, though, it is the agitator in Ryan Kessler that, you know, elicits power plays from the other team, that gets them off their game and allows the Canucks to take advantage. You take the good, you take the bad, but it is that kind of behavior, it is that kind of seesaw with Ryan Kessler that probably means he's not going to be the captain of this hockey club, and that's why they go with Henrik Sedin. And again, that might sound more harsh than I mean it to be, because I think that what he does is still valuable to this hockey club, but you can't have your captain, I don't think, playing that role. I thought that was an apropos night for maybe Ryan Kessler to behave exactly like that. Rob in Abbotsford. Rob, go ahead. You're on the Team 1040.
Yeah, guys. Great night tonight. Certainly very memorable. And for this game especially, for me, one that was lucky enough to, 40 years ago, be in the Pacific Coliseum and see that first goal. It was really neat to see Barry Wilkins and everybody come back. But, of course, with Tommy and Sedin, captaincy, all the rest of it. It's just
quite a night.
Oh, just a phenomenal night. But, you know, as somebody who worked in, I never got to know Tommy directly and personally. But I did work in the Vancouver media and had the most respect for him. But I'll tell you, especially after tonight, I have so much more respect for the man. He is just such a class act, and it's not surprising that people respect him and honor him and acknowledge him the way they have. And I would really love to see it. You know, we're talking about December when Naslin goes up in the rafters. I would love to see Tommy remembered, probably in the Jim Robson broadcast booth somehow, something somewhere in there that indicates, and for people that have collections of souvenir jerseys is one thing, which I do. I know what I'm doing this year. This sounds like a marketing job by the Canucks, but it's not. It's by me, a Canuck fan of 40 years. I'm going to get one of those jerseys with the patch on it, and I'm going to put 33 on it, and I'll know what that means.
Thanks, Rob. Appreciate it. 33 years for Tommy Larscheid in the broadcast booth. You know what? The media room downstairs has got a name attached to it, Norm Jewison. The broadcast booth, does Press Row guys, looking around at the guys left in the press, does Press Row have a name attached to it? I don't think it does.
And I'm happy we kept with him. With the thing with Tommy Larscheid, one thing I know about him, I don't know if his background's in hockey or not, but he's just that type of guy with a hockey fan first and tells it like it is, what I really appreciate. I got to meet him outside of his media, and he's just a very unselfish gentleman. I think I work the best to him in his future, but I think Vancouver are pretty lucky to have a guy like that. He's a good guy, so I hope him the best, and great show.
Thanks, Jordan. Appreciate it. Yeah, he is the best. Tommy, from the time I was a greenhorn in radio, came here with TV experience, obviously, when I came back to Vancouver in 2005, and Tommy was very welcoming, right from the get-go, helped make the transition to radio pretty darn easy for me. Victor in Richmond. Victor, go ahead. Hey, Victor.
Hello, how are you?
There we go. I'm good, thanks.
You're good. Actually, I just want to say something. You know what, I want to start off by saying I'm a hockey fan, but I'm not a huge Canucks fan. But you know what? I'm a huge Tom Larscheid fan. The guy is remarkable. Just being a neutral hockey fan, he's absolutely amazing to listen to. He makes the Canucks game so much fun. And, you know, I come home and I just listen to him. And especially when you follow other teams in the NHL and you see what else there is out there, there's no one else in the NHL that compares to him. And I think a lot of us have taken him for granted. And we really don't know what we're missing, but the guy's the best. He makes the passion and the energy he has for the game, it's unbelievable, and he's the best.
Thanks, Victor. Appreciate it. He's so good in the big games. You know, whether it was a playoff loss for the Canucks or a playoff win, Tommy was at his best when we're on the edge of our seats, right? When hockey fans are on the edge of their seats, Tommy echoes the sentiments. I mean, like it or love it or hate it, Tommy represents the fans. He did a great job of doing that. He really did. Chad in Burnaby. Chad, thanks for waiting. Go ahead.
What a great time, Don.
Good, thanks.
Yeah, just wanted to say I've been listening to Tommy for quite a while, and he brings the passion of a fan to the game. And as a Canucks season ticket holder, I have lost a lot of respect for Mike Gillis for orchestrating this or pushing him out. I've lost a lot of respect as a season ticket holder for him. And to be quite honest, the management at Team 1040 have lost a lot of respect. They didn't have the balls to stand up for him and to stand up to Mike Gillis to keep him in there. Because the fans definitely want him in there, as you can tell by tonight. So, yeah, that's all I have to say.
Chad, thanks for the call. On that note, General Manager Mike Gillis speaking after 20 minutes to the media, not in response to the retirement of Tommy Larscheid, but...
Oh, hey, guys. How's it going?
Good.
I just wanted to say I think Ham Hughes and Ballard look really well out there. I think, they played really tough, physical, smart hockey, and they're going to be a force to reckon with. As far as Mr. Larscheid, I've been driving a cab for the past 2 years in the North Shore, and I can say, like, he has definitely made radio a lot more fun for me and my customers to listen to. And if I ever did get a chance at home to watch a game, I would actually turn the TV commentating down and turn Tommy up, and that goes to tell you something. When I have to turn that down and turn Tommy up. Thanks, guys. Just wanted to hear what you said. Thanks.
That does say a lot, because, you know, we've had the pleasure of having guys like Jim Houston and Shorty a lot of the time calling on the TV side of things. So we're glad you did here on the Team 1040, but that's a compliment to the broadcast booth here that this is still such a quality broadcast that people are still doing that. Back in the day, I used to hear a little bit more about that, but the fact that it's still happening with Shorty and Houston calling the TV side, it says a lot about what both our commentators and our play-by-play guy and our color guys have done over the last few years. 280-TEAM, 280-8326, where we're going. Jonathan in Vancouver. Jonathan, go ahead.
Hello, yes, thanks for taking my call.
Yes, you're welcome. Go ahead.
Excellent. Yeah, I was at the game tonight, and I thought absolutely Hank was right. The penalty killing was awesome. But what I liked the most being there was seeing how Orlan Kurtenbach handed over the captaincy to Henrik. We didn't see a C on the ice until the presentation was made, and when he started taking off his shirt, it was quite something to see.
Yeah.
And whether Mike Gillis cares or not, I think he made the right choice.
Thanks for the call. Appreciate it. Let's move on to Jacob in Vancouver. Jacob, go ahead.
Keith Batter is a perfect example of that preseason means absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. Because everybody knows that he did not look that good in preseason. And first game as a regular season as a Canuck, he was easily the best Vancouver Canuck defenseman tonight. I thought he played very, very well, especially on that penalty kill. Actually, when was the last time you see a penalty kill that got a standing ovation, kind of like when the Sedins go on two-minute power play shifts? It was quite something to see, and I think that's what Malhotra and Ballard and Hanvius are really, really going to bring this year. And overall, pretty entertaining game tonight.
Jacob, thanks. So, yeah, for a 2-1 shootout victory, not bad entertainment value, you're right. Jason in Vancouver. Jason, go ahead.
Hi, guys. Thanks for the great show. I wanted to call in with a couple of comments about the interview with Mike Gillis talking about Hendrick's selection or his selection of Hendrick as captain.
Yeah.
First thing is just to commend what he looks for in a captain, which I guess you could say is common or cliche, but, you know, I think he really meant it, the character, on top of what Hendrick does on the ice, and including what he does in the community, which is really a great and important tie to the fans. And secondly, connecting Mike Gillis with the fans, I was disappointed about what his response to the question about, well, the fans seem to approve his selection, saying, well, it doesn't really matter, I approve. That left a little distaste in my mouth about what Mike's respect for the fans is, and perhaps a suggestion to him to think about what his relationship to the fans of Vancouver Canucks are.
I would hope that he meant something different. I would hope that he would like to take that back, because it came off sounding bad. No matter what his intentions were, it came off sounding bad. I'll agree with you on that one. T-Mart, don't know who's on line one if you want to fill me in on that. In the meantime, we'll go I will go there now, I guess. Billy in Kindersley. Billy, thanks for waiting. Go ahead.
Blake, how you doing?
Good.
I'm way out in the rigs in the middle of Saskatchewan, and I thought, you know, I can't watch the game tonight.
I was going to say, I don't know any Kindersley, B.C. I know Kimberly. Kindersley, Saskatchewan. Oh, okay,
Kindersley,
go.
Saskatchewan. Nice. So I took a risk, and I put it on 10:40 a.m., and I couldn't have been more happy to see that I get this crystal clear to hear.
Get out. Really? Crystal clear. No kidding.
I'm just across the border from Red Deer in Saskatchewan, so I can hear you guys perfectly. And to hear Tommy's last game, I was fortunate enough to intern and have him for half a dozen times in the booth there. And I just think he's one hell of a guy, and it was a great call to listen to tonight, and it's a sad thing to hear him go. And I also just want to give a huge shout-out to my friend SJ and Suzanne, who won the 50-50 tonight. And,
get out, really?
They're having a great party, I'm sure. This is my third friend in 2 years to win the 50-50. Good thing for the Canucks all around tonight. I just
Billy, me and you should talk more, honestly. We got to be pen pals or something. I need some of that mojo for the 50-50 coming my way.
Something like that, man. There's way too many people and not me winning it, but thanks. Good stuff, guys. I'm glad to hear you guys. I'm lonely out in Saskatchewan, and it was good to hear you guys.
Billy, thanks for the call. Appreciate it. That's great. The only thing that's similar to that is one time, who was it? One of the Sunners. I forget which one it was. Rich or Ron, we were talking about the elbow that Brandon Sutter took from Doug Waite way back a couple of years ago, and one of his uncles phoned in to us from Montana. It was Rich. You were producing that day, weren't you, Bakes? Rich Sutter phoned us from the highway in Montana. Getting us over the air. The wonders of AM radio, indeed. Tom in Salt Spring. Tom, go ahead. You're on the Team 1040.
Hi. I just wanted to phone you guys and let you know how much of a great influence Tom Larscheid has had calling games, and what a important part of the Vancouver Canucks. The interesting thing is that... he talked, we got the impression about respect and the honesty, and I noticed that you guys haven't commented at all when people have asked about Gillis and 1040 radio, you know, just kind of being yellow belly about the whole thing. So do you feel like 1040 is you know, has just rolled over on this? Yes or no?
I didn't fire him. What do you want me to say? I think it's sad that Tommy's not coming back, but I didn't make the decision, so that's all I can say. What do you want me to say?
Well, I think that it's going to affect a lot of fans, a lot of people, and also the radio.
Well, I know it will, Tom, but I didn't fire him, so I can't comment on the decision-making process. I wasn't in the room, wasn't told that it was going to happen. So when people call up and say that the team Ted 40 did this and Mike Gillis did that, what am I supposed to say? Other than I'm going to miss Tom. I wasn't involved in the decision-making process. So I certainly hope you're not calling me Yellow Belly because I had no input on the matter. If you knew that I had input, then I'm Yellow Belly. But I had no input, so you can't call me Yellow Belly.
Well, someone's towing the line.
Someone's towing the line. How am I towing the line?
Well, I mean, no one's saying anything about it.
I think we're all, we said all night how disappointed we are that this is the end of the line for Tom Larscheid. What else do you want me to say?
It'd be interesting to see what 1040 has to say about it.
Well, you can write them a letter then. I'm not going to throw my bosses under the bus. I wasn't involved in any of the discussions. You know, what broadcaster would come on the air and say, well, my bosses are idiots for doing this, 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 and this? I'm not going to do that. I'm sorry. I'm disappointed Tom's leaving. I wasn't involved in any way, shape, and form of the decision-making process. I can't comment. It's disappointing. That's all I can say.
Hey, how you doing, Blake?
Good.
I just wanted to make a couple comments. I thought I'm a traditionalist. I've been a Canucks fan for 35 years. I never missed a season. And the appointment of Henrik was the smartest thing they've done. I'm glad the experiment with the goalie captain's over. And I really, really like the idea that he allowed the captain, the guy that's playing on the ice with these guys, to make his selections of who he thinks is worthy of being an alternate. That was a great idea. And I wanted to say a couple of things from a fan's perspective about Tom Larscheid. You know, all the years that I listened to him, there were times where it bugged me and I couldn't stand him. And there's other times I just loved him. But one thing I can always say about him is he was honest and he always spoke the truth. And he wasn't a lackey. He didn't, throw the line and call it just because he was a Canucks fan. He would criticize just as much as he praised them. And I hope that whoever fills that chair is still able to be able to do that. Because to me, that's kind of what made it special, you know?
Well, no guessing. We know who it is. It's Dave Tomlinson. And, Dave's a player. He's going to come out from a different angle. He'll start off a little more X's and O's until he gets comfortable. And let's remember, you're going from a guy that's got 30 years of experience, 33 to be exact, to a guy who's just had a smattering of fill-in opportunities here the last couple of seasons with the Vancouver Canucks. Tommy, in his first couple of years, wasn't the Tommy we know now. So let's give Dave Tomlinson a little bit of a rope here to settle into the role. He's going to be pretty nuts and bolts, X's and O's here for the first little while, but he'll settle in. And I think the Dave Tomlinson you hear in January and February is going to be a lot different than the Dave Tomlinson you hear in October. So give him some time. Cody in Nanaimo. Cody, go ahead.
Hey, Blake. How's it going?
Good.
Right on. Just wanted to say I thought the Canucks looked good tonight. I thought Luongo looked really good. A big change in his game. And Tommy deserved everything and more that he got. And he's been the voice of the Canucks since I was old enough to figure out what hearing was, and it's sad to see him go, but it was a good night, I think, tonight, and good to hear him one last time.
One heck of a ride, indeed. Thanks, Cody. Thanks for the words. Appreciate it. Rick in Port Moody, last word on Tommy. Go ahead.
Hey, how's it going there, Blake?
Good.
Yeah, kind of in the same lines of just kind of a tribute to Tom for all of his years, but a little bit of insight onto some of the backlash that you're getting here from a lot of the callers in respect to how 1040 is handling the situation. Now, you probably weren't here when 1040 first came on the airwaves, but they were the
I was, but yeah.
Well, all right. Yeah. Well, then you'll remember that the guys you had on the radio then, there are a lot that are still on. Maybe some doing the afternoon show were very, very aggressive in calling out NW, who was carrying the Canuck games at the time, as being a homer team or a homer station that follows the team and kisses the butt of Burke, and there was a big Burke battle that was going on. And now it seems that the natural progression of the radio station, now that you guys are really the only sports station in the city, save NW doing their evening show. It appears that the appearance is very clearly that you guys are now clearly bent over, kissing the royal ass of the Canucks. And Gillis now, if the whole spin around has completely gone 180 degrees, Gillis is now the Burke of the early 2000s, late 1990s.
I was just thinking that myself earlier
when,
tonight.
When NW was you know the big Burke balloon and you know the,
yeah.
Burke was on the show on Dan's show once a week every Tuesday. You know what's happened now is we've gone a complete 180 and if we think back to what. To what 1040 was saying way back when you were coming on, that we will never be that. And as you know, as it turns out now, the evolution has occurred, and 1040 has become, whether you want to accept it or not, the exact station that NW was.
Well, I'm gonna say this, Rick. Be careful saying the whole station. Some guys, some individuals. Might toe the party line, but I don't think you can lump us all together.
Well, no. Well, all right. If we can't lump you all together, then there should be more cojones from DJ or from, actually, I keep calling you DJ, but from the radio hosts standing up to the direction that the station is going, following the royal hind end of Mike Gillis. And I don't dislike Mike Gillis, but certainly you guys have changed. Your plan and your format and your intentions that you were selling us on 10 years ago when you were coming on board, that we are not going to do that. Well, you know what? You've done it.
All right. Thanks, Rick. I'm sorry that you feel that way because I like to think that for the most part, the majority of what you hear is pretty balanced. Remember this, too, for anybody that's in the same mindset as Rick. When this team is good, it's tough to be overly critical of a very good team. If they're very good, if they're winning three straight division championships, for instance, it's hard to come off as a real grouch about the whole thing when they're playing pretty darn good hockey as a whole. You come off looking like a bit of an idiot, grousing all season long when the team wins division championships and has home ice advantage in the playoffs. So it might seem like that to you, but the progression has also been from a team that wasn't very good in 2000 when we came to the air, or whatever year it was, 2001, pardon me. You know, the team struggled that year. They weren't very good. And lo and behold, as the team has progressed now to 2010, there were Stanley Cup favorites, save for maybe one other year there in 03, 04, maybe the Canucks would have been in a similar boat. So when the team is poised to be this good, it's hard to stand on your pulpit every day and say, this team is headed in the wrong direction, there is no leadership, this is a bad team, the players are bad, when they're good. What?